Jeff, if you'd like to come up and introduce the History Day program, please.
History Day is just absolutely fantastic, and you know, I beg you all to come and be judges. So all of you that are here that are judges for History Day, stand up. I don't know about you all, but I really enjoy it a ton. Basically, you get there and all the students have their boards and they're talking, and then they set up in the room and you can just feel the nervous energy. So we invited some students here today that basically exemplify History Day. So I'm going to also have Colleen Toasty come up and talk about rising stars and History Day.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for having us. Taking off from Jeff, so this, it depends each year kind of on the National History Day theme, the participation that kids can get behind. Sometimes there's kind of vague themes and we don't get a lot of participation. Thankfully, this year was a really good year. It was taking a stand, and that comes from the National History Day organization. And so you had anything from Julia Butterfly Hills to Winston Churchill to Robert F. Kennedy, Roe versus Wade. It was a wonderful, wonderful collection. So we had roughly, I think it was close to 500 students in Humboldt County participate. Out of those 500, 80 were named county champions, and three of them are here today. Very, very high quality this year. We kept hearing from judges, I have never seen projects like this. Two of our kids that are here were in the exhibit category. There is the largest one, tons of competition in that one. And so to be named a county champion is huge. Then you have to go on to the state History Day. And of course it's in Roseville or Rockland, where you can imagine the price of a hotel there, and the gas, and the food, and the registration fee is $100 to even participate. So we are really, really grateful for organizations like Sunrise Rotary, because we got to get 72 students down there to participate. And Gary Eagles, it was always important to him to remove any obstacles to our kids from here participating. We don't want to hear that a kid can't afford to go or a kid doesn't have anything to wear to be able to go. And so I really, really appreciate your support. It definitely takes a village to get them down there. So at State in Rockland, there are 1,400 students this year, all the way from the San Diego all the way up to Humboldt and Delaware County. And so you can imagine the competition there. We worked before State History Day with these kids on interview skills. We had experts that locally helped them enhance their projects. I was able to go to State History Day last year, and I was bowled over. You know, we think our kids are just rock solid, and you get down there and the competition they're facing is really, really stiff. Of the 70 that ended up going, 27 of our local students received some sort of distinction. Those that didn't had to withstand very, very tough interviews. It was just amazing. And so we have so much to be proud of in our kids here. And so the next thing to recognize is our state champions. We had two kids from Zane, they're eighth graders, that were actually named California State History Day champions. And so they get to go on to nationals at the University of Maryland next month. Of course, there's also an entry fee there. I mean, it's just amazing that these kids get this distinction, but now they got to find a way to get across the country and pay the registration fee and the meals and everything that goes along with that. But what a huge honor for Humboldt County. And I was talking to Fred Van Fleck, who is the superintendent of Eureka City Schools yesterday. Eureka City Schools is going to pledge $1,000 toward those kids' trip, which is wonderful. And there's another thing, it really takes a village. Next up for Rising Stars, kind of switching gears real quick, is Seal It by Literacy next Tuesday. That is kids who have received proficiency in more than two or more than one language. Some kids are doing three, including English. Some kids are doing two, including English. We've got German and Spanish and French and Tagalog, and there's a variety. Last year we had 90 students receive it. They're all high school seniors. This year, 129. And again, it's just a huge celebration of what Humboldt County kids can do with our support and providing a venue. These kids went through a written essay. They had to go through an oral essay by HSU professors and their teachers. And so much to be proud of. And then the last event of the school year is going to be the industrial technology, and that's the woodworking and the metals. This year we're doing something different. It's going to be the Showcase of Excellence. And we're going to have an evening event to recognize those kids, their teachers, their families, and that'll be June 6th. at Sequoia. If you would like to attend either of those events, please let me know and I'll give you the details. We'd love to have your support. I mean, to sit there at these events, to sit there and watch these kids and see what they come up with, your jaw just drops. I mean, it really is amazing. I'm sorry if I took too long.
No, the thing is,
I really want to thank Jeff because not only is he judge at History Day, but then we organized two coaching sessions post-history, post-county, so to try and really get these kids ready. And then to determine who really rises to the top that we'd like to award merit scholarships. So League of Women Voters participates, Sunrise Rotary participates, but it is hours and hours of looking at the kids' projects, of listening to their potential interviews, and then to sit in a room with 15 other people and vie for the projects that you saw. And there's Jeff saying, I really like Greta and Ethan's. I want them to get a scholarship, but I really like Ruby's. And someone says, but I like Sally's, and that kind of thing. So it's a lot of deliberation. So again, to those three that received these scholarships, very, very high. 70 kids vying for these scholarships, and I believe 20 received them, 24 received them, all told. And so again, congratulations to you guys, and thank you for all of the hours that you give to our kids. It's wonderful.
They deserve it. So Ethan and Greta, why don't you come on up? And then you can set up the board right now, and then you can say, yeah, I was really impressed with Ethan and Greta's project here. And so just listening to them talk about it, as you will now, you'll see why. You want to put it up?
So again, thank you guys for your donation and sponsoring us to go down to state yesterday. Our project is about the Chilean coup of 1973, where Pinochet rose to dictatorship in Chile. And so basically, we kind of got the idea to start this project because we both kind of have connections to Chile, where we had a foreign exchange student last year from Chile, and then we got it. Let's have the truth.
Yeah. Just yeah, hold it, Jeff.
I can't go.
There you go.
This is history day, not it?
Yeah. Yeah. No.
Choosing this topic because I went to Chile when I was younger, so I have family friends that live go down there every year. So kind of both have that connection to the country, and it's cool to see that apply. I was talking about this actually the other day, but having visited Chile and knowing that just like 10, 20 years ago they were living in such a dictatorship, it's crazy to think that such a beautiful country had such terrible things happening in it just so shortly.
Oh yeah, well we're interested in this topic because it's a lot different than everybody else's. Everybody else seems to look for a positive stand, but we it's more of a negative light to see something that somebody did not do for the right reasons, and most people don't quite realize that the U.S. dictatorships and the fact that this is still going on today is irrelevant.
Yeah, so a lot of our research was based off of the people that were involved in the coup. So we kind of started with President Allende, who was the Chilean president who was dubbed socialist, and he was overthrown by Pinochet and the coup. And then a couple different important people are Kissinger, obviously, who was really, really important in involved in the coup and pushing towards that. And Nixon. And then there's also business interests in Chile. That was a really important part of our project was how because the United States had business interests in the copper mining industry, they were more inclined to support the coup and support Pinochet, who didn't want to nationalize the copper industry.
And we just decided to go with the Red Guard to kind of do one of those crime scene boards to see who did it, and we like it shows all the connections, all the intertwining connections with all the different characters in the area. shows how central PCU is to everything that happened. It's really important.
And then the one thing they kind of brought our project home was our section about Victor Jara, which kind of showed the impact that Pinochet had on Chile and the Chileans. And I don't know if you guys know about him, but he was like a socialist and he was a political activist in Chile. But at one point, I think it was like 12,000 people were put into a stadium, and I think they were all killed or they were just trapped in the stadium. But Victor Jara was one of those people, and his like hands were cut off, and he was a musician. So one other thing that we had was like a video of Victor Jara's last song, and it was about all those people in the stadium. Any questions at all?
How many lost their lives?
Like 3,000 people ended up dead or missing during the war. And they were known as the disappeared.
And Salvador Allende himself?
Yeah, he was assassinated.
You talk about his daughter and her work. Her daughter Isabel is a novelist.
Yeah. We're very limited on space. Word count. It's quite a lot to fit.
Yeah, it's very good experience too, just being with all those. There was some really awesome projects too at State History Day. Exhibits are phenomenal, so it was good to be in that atmosphere.
So I have a question about the logistics. When you're there at State, do they come around and you give a presentation and they look at your board or whatever?
Yeah, we have like an interview time, so then we go and wait and then the judges come and meet us. They stand in front of our board and ask us questions.
Scary.
Yeah.
That's what I think.
And they have looked at the board before they ask you questions?
Yeah.
Or?
And they've read our process paper.
Okay. All right. Thank you. Okay. Ruby DeBoe.
Yes.
Can you talk about what? Marisa. Okay.
I want to interrupt you for a second because I have a little story and I'm sorry to interrupt, but it's too good not to share. So. For County History Day, the paper judges get the papers ahead of time, about a week, and they are all HSU professors. And so they're reading through them, and all of a sudden one of our local coordinators got a call from one of them and said, I've got this paper by Ruby DeVoe of Jacoby Creek School, and this is not done by an elementary, what grade are you in, eighth grade? There's no way this can be done by a junior high student. This is college level work. I'd like you to contact the school and make sure that this is authentic, because there is no way, I can't believe this. And so the coordinator got in touch with their teacher, Kirk Goddard. I don't know if you knew this.
No.
Okay.
I don't go
So anyway, but it goes to show how special these kids are. So contacted and Kirk Goddard said, oh no, I know Ruby's work. This is Ruby's work. This is the kind of level of students we have here. And so then it went to, of course, those coaching sessions, and the coach that we had, again, connected to HSU, wanted to let everyone know, not only is this college-level work, it is a senior in college-level work. Now you can talk about your experience.
Okay, so I wrote a paper, a research paper, and it was about Jacoby Creek School, and it was about Harriet Tubman during the Civil War, and it was about how her work in the Civil War is often overshadowed. She's a pretty well-known figure, but she is known for her work in the Underground Railroad more so than her time in the Civil War, where she was a spy and a nurse and a cook and a soldier and a leader in the Combahee River Raid. And so I kind of came across the project because I had written a previous paper in class for a project for school. And when I was done, I felt that I hadn't really covered like her whole life story, so when it came time for History Day, I chose to do a project on her time during the Civil War because I felt that was really an important part of her career as an abolitionist, and it had a lot more impact, some you could say, than leading small groups
to Canada and on the Brown Railroad. So I felt that it was important to highlight, you know, that version of her story that's not told so often. So, it was really interesting because I, you know, a lot of people know Harriet Tubman, but I had to read a book for this school project, and I didn't realize before that either that she was even in the Civil War at all. But when I did, I realized that she was a lot more than just, you know, like the kind of mythicized member of the Underground Railroad. She was a feminist, and she was, after the Civil War, she was very poor, but she ran a home for the needy, even though she was herself quite needy, and she was just a very complex figure, but she is really kind of only one side of her story is told very often, so I felt it was important to talk about the other side of her story,
Was this your first time going to state?
Yeah, it was my first time in History Day at all, in National History Day. I had done it last year, but only for school, so I hadn't entered, and I didn't even plan on entering in the competition this year, but then after I wrote the paper, my teacher said, you should really enter, so I'm like, okay, and I did. But this year, I'm definitely going to do it next year. I'm going to plan on entering in the National History Competition.
So how does the process work with papers at the state? Do you?
We submitted it online, and then the judges all read it, and then when we arrived, so all the people that were judging me, I think that at least we had three judges interviewing us, and so we would arrive and we would have this big mob outside the door of the library just waiting for our names to be called, and it was kind of stressful, but then you would go in and they've all read your paper and they were sitting there and they would interview you, and then it was a pretty short interview and then they would, you know, judge it more based on the interview, I guess, and then send it on if they chose it, and then the next judges would read it. But yeah, so we submitted it electronically.
And Ruby, tell us how we did.
I made it to the semifinals.
Website. Maybe Brian can get the URL for us and we can all look for it.
Okay.
So fourth place is, you know, if you can imagine, amazing. 1,400 kids. Awesome.
Jeff, can I just add something to Colleen's little story, which sounds really entertaining, but let me tell you how it happened at home. So Ruby had this, and she might want me to tell you this, but we will anyway. she had originally done this essay just because she was going to get an extra credit at school, or it was required that there was an extra credit component, and she'd been thinking about it, but she hadn't started till the night before it was due.
Not quite.
So she had been mulling it over, you know, it'd been, you know, in the hopper there, actually hit the page yet, till probably, you know, 5 o'clock in the afternoon. and she's like, Mom, I'll read my essay, can you read it when I'm done? It's like, yeah, all right. And it gets to 11 o'clock, she's like, okay, I'm done, can you read it? And it's like, it's 11 o'clock, I'm going to bed. And I read it quickly, and I gave her about two comments. and said, well, this is a bit of a run-on sentence. You can make two sentences out of this and two sentences out of that. And that was as much parental input as that essay got. And I didn't realize that right after that, I didn't even cross-check it for spelling, grammar, anything. She hit the submit button, and it's like, what? That was it? So it was very much Ruby's work.
Greta and Ruby, thank you so much for coming and sharing. And so I just wanted, there's one last thing I want to say is that this is the Bill Tanner Memorial Scholarship. And so a lot of you remember that. And so, and Bill Tanner. And so he was a history professor up at HSU and a big supporter of the community. So thank you, kids.
And Professor Tanner's wife, Fran, was a member of this club for a long time, so there's another connection there. Well, thank you very much. You all did great, and I hope that this inspires more people to be History Day judges next year when Jeff puts out the call. And thank you, Jeff, for your leadership on this and for the pancake breakfast and all the other stuff that you did.
Yeah, fantastic.